Last but not the least, I would like to invite Mr. Pramod Joshi from GLA University, without whose support this mammoth exercise would not have been really possible. He is an academic thinker in his own right, so his views on the entire program and how it will be taken forward. So.
Thank you, Raghav, and good evening to all of you and to the esteemed dignitaries on the dais. It's a great pleasure being here on behalf of GLA University. I have an advantage being an advisor to the GLA University. I am not part of the organization. I am only an advisor to the Chancellor. So the advantage is that if I make any claims and it turns out to be false, I can always wash my hands off it. Some people here who represent the organization obviously cannot have that advantage. I also have a disadvantage, of course. Coming at the end of so many speeches, it's going to be very tough to match, let alone outdo, the acts of oratory that you have just heard. I really learned a lot in the last 3 hours, and I thank you all for your patience being here. I can see that many of you have traveled from long distances. बड़ी दूर से आप आए हैं, गुजरात से आए हैं, राजस्थान से आए हैं, हरियाणा से आए हैं, और आपने यहाँ बैठ के इतने लोगों को सुना. I'm sure you are going to go back excited, your mental faculties activated to think about the future. GLA University is just another university in the state of UP. It started off as an institution under the UP Technical University. My association with this university is very accidental. I used to run a software company. I am from the information technology background. And this university sent its representatives to my office. I was the managing director, and I was requested to come there and hire a few students. It's very normal for any university or institution to seek placement opportunities with companies. So I obviously didn't need that kind of manpower, so I said I'll come and visit. I made the visit, and just a few things. You know, Mathura is quite far from, but 10 years back when I went there, it was further away. Today we have the Yamuna Expressway, which makes it much more convenient. And I was touched by a certain ethos in the university. It was at that time not a university. The humility of the people who were at the helm of affairs, the desire to do something for society, the passion to do things in small ways and continually improve. I found that very, very inspiring. And that's when I started going there gratis, just to train the students, just to tell them that there's a big world out there, just to tell them how to start dreaming and thinking about the future. I don't want to take any credits, but slowly that association morphed into a very holistic relationship. I ended up doing faculty development workshops there. I left the IT industry, by the way, back in 2005, and I moved into education because I could see, just like pointed out by Mr. Saxena and many others, education is the critical success factor for this country. That young man who said, "I would like to make the country like Japan and Germany," knew what he was talking about. China is okay, an economic power house, that's okay. But when it comes to quality, when it comes to precision engineering, there is nothing to match Germany, nothing to match Japan. I mean, you go to the US, I lived in the US for about 10 years. Japanese products sell like hotcakes. Chinese products don't make it even to the market there. So I really laud that gentleman or the young man who talked about this kind of competition. You know, we can learn a lot from young people like that. So I found that in a place like Mathura, students had very strong dreams. They wanted to change, and so I said, let's help them get to their dreams. Faculty development workshops then led to strategic advice to the university on how to improve, how to seek excellence. And about 3 years back, I was invited to be an advisor to the Chancellor in my personal capacity. I've been doing that. See, as an advisor, you have a very touchy role. You have to bring some bad news. You have to also challenge the thinking of the ownership and the management. The reason I have survived for 3 years while being very, very vocal about some issues is because they listen to negative criticism also. They have the capacity to digest criticism, and slowly and steadily, anyone who is humble enough to say, yes, I can do better, yes, I am wrong, I can change, usually such people go a long way. And that's the reason I have stuck with GLA University. I am completely committed, and I'm sure that this university, it may take 20 years, it may take 30 years, but it is on the right track. It's progressing at a steady pace. It is trying to improve quality of faculty, quality of the campus, the student life. I have been a very big fan of sports and extracurricular activities in the building up of character of any young student. And thanks to some of my advice, they have invested heavily in sports coaches, in playgrounds. They have acquired more land, which is just left open for students to play in the evenings. So I think a holistic environment is being created there. And Engineering Watch, the people behind Engineering Watch, Raghav and Ravi and others, I think there is a clear synergy between the way they think about education in India and the way GLA University thinks about it. So we have no doubts about backing such an initiative, and we hope to continue to be a partner of this very excellent initiative. Raghav also said, what can we do in the future? I think it's great to see a cohort of fellows, scholars and laureates. That's the three categories I'm told. So if you can every year get this group of students to become a meta group, which means they may all go to different universities. Some will join United, some will join APJ, some will join GLA, some will go to IITs. Wherever they go, this is a like a spark of energy. If we can harness their collective thoughts through social media platforms, which can be hosted on Engineering Watch maybe website, I mean, you're talking about a real transformational energy from these 150, 200 students. And every year you will have another cohort coming. So Engineering Watch can actually be the platform for the kind of innovation that Mr. Saxena was talking about. Saxena ji ne bahut ahem sawal uthaye hain, bahut uttejit bhi kiya hai aapko, aur main baaki unka dhanyawad dunga ki unhone itne khule man se, he has really spoken about what needs to be done in India, how we need the next generation of students to really look at life. In fact, I was on a program hosted by Engineering Watch about a month back, and the title of the program was Why Engineering? I think it is being telecast on some channels also. And I had the good fortune of sharing the platform with the Vice Chancellor of UP Technical University, Professor Khandal. And you know, that time there was this question, why engineering? And I responded by saying, why not engineering? So to all the students who are sitting here, you are really entering a stream of study which is possibly going to be the most exciting for the next 20, 30 years. Why? Because a country like India needs so many technology solutions. We have labor, we have resources. What we need is the engineering and technology skills to really bring everything together to solve the problems of the 1.25 billion people that reside in this country. And why not? We can be problem solvers to the rest of the world. In fact, at GLA University, we started a polytechnic last year with 450 students who will not do engineering degrees, they will do diplomas. They will be trained on hands-on skills that are needed in the industry today. So there are many such initiatives around the country. And if we can harness this energy, and if Engineering Watch becomes the fulcrum of this particular movement of innovation, I think they would have done a great service to the nation. I really hope that all of you, whatever choices you make, be a good engineer, because the good engineer is always analytical. So make sure you look at the choices before you, analyze the pros and cons of each choice, and then make a considered judgment about where you want to go. And if you make a few mistakes in the process, don't worry. The career before you is 40 years, 50 years. Don't worry at all where you end up going. You can always make up for one slip here and there. Life has enough opportunities. Please do not feel that you might have made a mistake in choosing a particular branch. There are people who have done chemical engineering, then they have gone and done an MBA in finance and have become CFOs of very large companies. So they have succeeded too. There are some people who have done engineering and then gone on to start an NGO to take care of education in villages. Those are successful people too. So I request all parents and all students to really look at life in more than just a technical sense. Be an engineer, but be also a non-engineer. There was a lady who came here as a mentor. She said, I am an arts person. I do clinical counseling. I try to help students come out of trauma. You know, so as a non-engineer, you must go and look at arts. You must visit museums. When I was at IIT BHU doing my engineering, I was more on the sports field than I was attending classes. Of course, I attended classes, but for me, life was with students, with my seniors, who were my mentors. I learned so much from my seniors, and I learned so much in the sports field. When I ran companies, it was my ability to deal with people in pressure situations on the sports field that helped me run companies. So I must request all of you to look at life in a more holistic way. Look at how you can build connectedness to issues, to people. An engineer cannot be a non-citizen. An engineer has to be a concerned citizen. So I was very pleased in the last elections. I am not a political supporter of any party. I look at good governance. Anybody who brings good governance for me is a good party. I was very pleased that the percentage of polling was at least 10% above the previous version, and that was mainly because a lot of young men and women came out and voted, and their participation in India's democracy, I think, augurs very well for the next 20-30 years. And I think it was Mr. Modi who made a very smart comment at one place. I think it was in Varanasi or at some other rally. He said, people who are 3 year and 4 year old are talking about this change, and 16 years down the road, they will be voters. And that was a very astute comment. He was looking 16, 18 years ahead. That's the sign of a visionary leader. I am, by the way, not trying to endorse any particular party. I think there are many visionaries in many other parties. So without taking further time, I just wanted to thank all of you for being here. I wanted to congratulate the fellows, the scholars, and of course the laureates. I'm told there are only 10 laureates. And I want to assure that GLA University, on behalf of the Chancellor of GLA University, I want to assure you that this program will find its fullest support from all of us in terms of thought, leadership, in terms of resources, in terms of ideas for making it much better. Thank you so much for listening to me. I know I wasted a lot of your time, but good luck, all the best, and good evening.
Thanks a lot.